reading through the brief, I love all the stories, the whole kind of thing, because you were in Vegas in the absolute heyday of Vegas,
weren't you?
When did the Elvis incident happen? When was that?
When Elvis made the first time, or the second time he was in Vegas, which has got to be 25 years ago. And I had a jumpsuit. You weren't born.
I was.
And I had a jumpsuit, and it was open to there.
Dame Shirley.
Buttons. Oh, I wasn't Dame then. I was a top. I was a top. And we were talking, and I was talking, actually. rabbit. And he was doodling down my front. And I didn't realize until he got to there. And it was incredible sensation.
What was he doodling with, Dame Shirley?
Well, he said it was a biro. it was a bishop. And when I went to bed that night, alone, I took off my jumpsuit, and there was this doodle all the way down. And I just went to bed. I said, I'm not going to wash. And for a week, I was going...
Bit of eye rope.
Yeah, I kept it there, and it wore off. Yes.
Now, I met Elvis in 1970. I got a thing that says, Elvis wants to meet you. I got to the Hilton Hotel. Elevator opened up, and it was me, Liza Minnelli, Chubby Checker, and Linda Lovelace.
Wow. What, you'd come together, or you just happened to be in that list?
No, he invited those four people
really? That
night. So we went up, and they searched us for guns, which was kind of silly, because there were guns everywhere once you got in. When he came in the room, he was Elvis. He wasn't the fat Elvis. He was Elvis. He was the guy. He goes, hey, man, you're the cat with a snake, ain't you? He said, yeah. And he goes, that's cool, man. I wish I would have thought of that. That's cool, man. He said, hey, I want to show you something. We go in the kitchen. He opens a drawer, takes out a loaded 38, snub-nosed 38, puts it in my hand. And he says, I'm going to show you how to take this gun out of somebody's hand.
A little devil's
here on my shoulder says, shoot him. A little angel over here says, don't kill him, just wound him. Before I could decide what to do, I was on the floor. And he's had his boot in my throat. I'm going, ha, it's good, Elvis. That's good.
I'm still reeling over the fact that you were there with Liza Minnelli.
Oh, yeah.
He must have thought you were sisters.
Well. Of course, only three of us came down on the elevator that night. Now, I don't know what he did with Chubby Checker all night. I'll tell you what, he was an amazing character, very funny guy.
Wow.
But he was Elvis, yeah. I mean.
People of my age, I was like, did you hear that? You know, who's this guy, Elvis Presley? And you got to say, yeah, he hit like a bombshell. Yeah, it was like the world went from black and white to Technicolor.
Of course, there were others at Sun Records. Charlie Rich was there. So was Conway Twitty. And there was another one. In fact, after appearing at high school auditoriums and places like that, I worked my very first concert as a guest, and he was a star. And he always was a star. Because all of us remember him and how he loved gospel songs and how we liked him, this song is for Elvis. Come on, fellas, let's do it for him.
And just to show you how important Elvis Presley is, and just to show you how important you are, you and all of you and our staff have received a letter from the President of the United States. And this is how it reads. I send greetings to those gathered for Elvis Week 2006. Laura and I recently visited Graceland with Prime Minister Koizumi of Japan, and we were reminded that Elvis Presley will forever have a special place in the cultural life of America. As a talented singer, performer, and actor, the King thrilled audiences around the world and brought joy to generations of people. Today, Elvis fans everywhere continue to sing his songs and recognize his many contributions to music and entertainment. This event is an opportunity for people from around the globe to come together, share memories, and celebrate one of America's most beloved icons. I appreciate all those who work to make this event a success. Your efforts contribute to the cultural fabric of our country and help carry on the legacy of one of the world's most popular performers.
I met Elvis in 1965, the first year that I was in show business. And I got the opportunity to meet him in Los Angeles. And I went to the Paramount Studios to talk about a song for a movie. And they said, Elvis is here today and he'd like to meet you. Oh, Jesus, I didn't know that he knew I existed because it was early on, you know. And I met him and he said to me, how the hell do you sing like that? I said, well, you were partly to blame, you know, listening to what he had done. So we became friends.
Well, soul has no color, has no barrier. But I also had a lot of good people that brought out a lot. I want to pay a tribute to a good friend of mine, Brother Elvis Presley, who opened up a lot of doors for me to get through. Elvis was a pioneer, and he came out 1 year before I did. He was out in 55, mm-hmm. Heartbreak Hotel. And then I come in 56. And Elvis and I were very good friends up until the last minute of his bodily life. But he'll always live because of the fact he was such a beautiful man. I don't care what nobody say, I know Elvis. You know, there are a lot of rumors. Elvis and I sang spiritual together. And he'd buy any movie that I'd make, or any film, he'd buy the film and close the theater up and show it. I love Elvis for being a man. I love him for what he'd done for the people and the chance he gave me. He kept me from being number one. I was number one soul and he was number one world, and it took a long time, but it's almost like the two rental cars. Uh-huh. It made me try harder. And I love Elvis for it. And we'll always pray for Elvis.
He is getting his Elvis on, getting his Elvis on. Here comes.
Oh yeah, man. We used to do. When you know, really young, you get so you're influenced so much by it. And I saw Love Me Tender, his first film, you know. Mm-hmm. And we were all so excited. We were sitting there, I think me and John, a couple of the guys, sitting there. Waiting for Elvis, you know, but it was a kind of like it was a film.
It's a story.
And yeah. You know, you first saw him, he was in a field with a plow and a horse. And you go, yes, that's him. And then it kind of cut in on him, you know, hey, and the cinema went wild. And then, but there's no singing, you know, and he's talking and all that. We're going, yeah, well, okay, that's good, but. And then he suddenly. They're talking about the house leaking and stuff. He grabs the guitar. Well, there's a leak in this old building. Yes, there's a leak in this old building.
Right.
And then there's a hole in the roof where the rain pours in. A hole in the floor where it runs right out again.
Yeah. And I was like, yes. This place went wild.
Man.
And then I heard Elvis, and you know, I was about nine or something like that, and this voice came across in amongst Pat Boone and Johnny Mathis and all the stuff that was part of the Valium that we still know about today. Elvis came straight through, and he had the Blue Note, he was listening to Sleepy John Estes, he was listening to the guy who did That's All Right Mama, thank you, yeah.
I get like that now. And he got all this stuff, Mystery Train, Junior Parker's Blue Flames. I didn't know anything about the references. I didn't know anything about what I know now, where it came from, but I heard that voice. And no matter how his image has been maligned and how it ended up, when I met Elvis with Led Zeppelin one evening in L.A.
Oh, that alone. Hold it. Let's pause for a minute. Let's just drink that in for a second. And I think that's the thing, that the more time that goes by, the easier it is for people to get confused about how important Elvis's moment was, because, you know, because there's always the feeling that, well, they're not giving enough credit to Chuck Berry and Bo Diddley and Little Richard and so on, which is true.
Right.
But Elvis rearranged the mainstream. If Elvis hadn't taken it from How Much Is That Doggy in the Window and turned it into this is mainstream popular music, then Little Richard and Chuck Berry and Jerry Lee Lewis would not have had the opportunity to get through it all.
Sure, and he was also white, which was crucial. Because that gave him the foot in the door that maybe Alan Freed was trying to do with Chuck and Bo and all that sort of stuff. But he was, and he was just, he was a great looking guy. And he actually, that physical representation, when, by the time he got to England, guys would like hit themselves on the head. Bang, what's going on? Who's this human being? It was fantastic in the middle of all that crap.
Yeah. Okay. I gotta tell you, we were having lunch and it was really fantastic. We're at this big table in this wonderful rustic building where you eat your meals, and the phone rang and somebody just casually said, "Mohammed, it's Elvis." And I thought, "Come on, Elvis who?" You know, it was really Elvis Presley.
No, that fellow was joking.
Oh no, he was. Since we own television,
we can't, because Elvis could hear about this.
Oh, no.
It wasn't real.
No, you know what he told me?
He wanted to impress you that I was a popular fellow.
No, Elvis called, and he told me, he put me on the phone with Elvis, and I talked, and Elvis said, "I'm his number one fan." I didn't know that. Where did you meet him? In Las Vegas?
In Las Vegas.
Yeah. He's quite a guy, isn't he?
Yeah.
Called from Memphis, and he said, "I'm going to be opening in Las Vegas soon," and I talked to him about maybe coming on the show. He said, you have to talk to the colonel.
I'm telling you, that fellow was an imposter. You wouldn't believe that was Elvis.
Oh, I know that one. Nobody could fool this here. When I heard that voice, I knew it was true.
And one night, because Elvis would go on at 8, I'd go on at 10, Elvis had gone at 12, and I'd gone at 2. And I'm doing my 10 o'clock show, and Elvis was walking, you know, back through the kitchens and the stuff, and he walks past my showroom in the back, and I'm doing Love and Feeling, and he used to do Love and Feeling in his show, and he stops the guys and he says, "Hey, Bill's doing my song, man." So they come in the back door, and I'm on stage, and when you're on stage, it's like you're in your living room at night, and if somebody walks in, it's really kind of startling. You know where everybody is, and there's some rustling from the side, and here comes Elvis Presley, and about four of his bodyguard, four of the Memphis guys, and he just walks by me and hits me on the arm, says, "Hi, Bill," and keeps on going. And I don't know what the bodyguards were. I didn't know if maybe he thought I was going to jump him on stage. But they walk by, and obviously the crowd just wigs out. Now, and I don't say anything. And he just walks off. And now I'm doing my 2 o'clock show. And in those days, the town was small enough that everybody in town knew that Elvis Presley walked on stage with Bill Medley. Because at least in one of his books, it said he had never been on stage with another artist or something like that. And so that there was lines to get in my show, like he's going to do it again.